The biggest night perhaps in their history. Wembley awaiting them, who knows, for the first time. In goal for them, Stephen Pearce, the ex-Manchester United man who pulled off some excellent saves in the first leg. Four at the back, including Tony Mowbray, the Borough captain, back after suspension. Still no Colin Cooper, who's injured. Nicky Mohan again deputises for him, but switching tonight to left back. In midfield, a setback for Borough then. They're without Mark Brennan, last week's match winner. He's suspended for this one. Trevor Putney comes in to partner Mark Proctor and Paul Kerr, with Bernie Slaven wide on the left. Two up front, Stuart Ripley outstanding in the first leg, and Alan Kernaghan preferred in this side to Peter Davenport, who is fit again, but in fact is one of the two substitutes. And so then to the Aston Villa lineup. Nigel Spink, of course, something of a permanent fixture at goal for Aston Villa, their longest serving player now. And at the back, Villa play with three central defenders, Kent Nielsen, Paul McGrath and Derek Mountfield, a system that of course releases two attacking fullbacks in Chris Price and Kevin Gage. In fact, showing Stuart Gray in that side, but Gray in fact has been left out of the lineup. So Gage is out, Chris Price wearing the number two shirt for Aston Villa. Two in the centre of midfield, then Gordon Cowans, a wise old head and superb passer of the ball, alongside him David Platt, who of course made that surprise recovery from injury in time for the first leg. Platt very much the man in form, and he is the Aston Villa captain tonight. Two up front in Oldie and Ormondroyd. And here is the referee, David Allison from Lancaster, who took charge of the Merseyside derby on Saturday. So he's gone from one big game to another, and it really is a cracking atmosphere. The ground absolutely packed, although Aston Villa haven't taken up their full allocation of tickets. But certainly there's a big following here for Middlesbrough. It'll be Aston Villa in the change strip, white shirts with black trimmings and black shorts to kick off. David Platt with Ian Oldie, and they're attacking the goal to our left in the first half. The referee just checking that all is well. We're waiting now then for the kickoff. Wembley awaiting the winners. Aston Villa trailing by 2-1 from the first leg at Villa Park. Can they turn it round tonight? Away they go. And just looking out straight away, Ormondroyd operating down the right flank from the off, with Tony Daly down the left. Kent Nielsen with the tackle then on Ripley, who caused so many problems for Aston Villa in the first leg at Villa Park. Ian Ormondroyd, who has been playing down the left for Aston Villa. A tactical change here, which we'll ask Ron Atkinson about in just a moment. He did have a feeling that Ormondroyd might change roles tonight. Was that what you had in mind, Ron?
Well, I wonder whether he'd actually play out on the wide or whether he'd play straight to the middle. I think the reasoning for that is last week Parkinson put such a stranglehold on him that Graham Taylor's looked at it and thought, well, maybe Daly's extra pace and the ability to go on the inside might just cause Boro a few problems that they hadn't anticipated.
Away by Mountfield, powerfully away. One of those three central defenders employed by Aston Villa, and to such good effect, of course, in recent matches. Mountfield, the former Everton defender. So much success during his time with Goodison Park. I wonder if he's going to add another Wembley final appearance in Aston Villa's colours. Forward by Mohan, here's McGrath. Got himself in one or two tangles last week, Paul McGrath. And in fact, didn't play in the second half. He went off with an injury. But such an important player for Aston Villa. A swirling wind out there. They've had no rain, but some spray on the pitch this afternoon. Certainly blustery, as you can see from the linesman's flag there. Taking the throw then for Aston Villa. Goldie, Ormondroyd. Steered back by Simon Coleman. And really, that was the strength of the Borough performance last week, on the defensive display with the two at the back.
That's right. Mohan and Coleman last week did exceptionally well. They held a very, very high starting position and didn't allow Villa to get too close to the their penalty. I wonder whether the same tactics tonight will apply. They have, of course, got Mowbray, who's actually an outstanding head with the ball. I'm sure if you set plays and things like that, he's going to be invaluable.
Here's Olney. Now then to Cowans. Again, so much urgency shown by Pass set for flat, off goes Ormond-Droyd. Released though by Mohan. They're all here tonight, all ages, and I would think there are some 70-year-olds in the crowd tonight who've never seen, of course, Middlesbrough and Wembley. I wonder if their dream is going to come true. Nigel Spink, cool, experienced goalkeeper. Parkinson. Risking the back pass. Two pairs. Harry Parkinson did a fine job last week at Villa Park, keeping Ormond-Droyd under control. He has the threat of Daly to deal with this time. McGrath with Ripley renewing their battle of a week ago. Here's Mowbray, strong, resilient defender. Difficult ball though for the goalkeeper. David Allison deciding it was a foul by Olney. But a ball he had to go for, huh?
That's right, I mean, it was out in the open, the lads made a genuine challenge for it. Thought Mowbray took a little bit of a risk. There's a slight wind, I would guess, blowing at his back, and he's played that back pass into the wind, and it's held up a little bit.
Here we can see it again. It's certainly only challenging. I'm not sure that was a foul.
No, but of course, anybody touches the keepers nowadays, referees, rightly or wrongly, automatically give a free kick, don't they?
Ian Olney, who's been very sharp in the penalty area, only 20 years old. Daly's header. This is Putney. That was a rash challenge then by Cowans. The referee just checking the Putney's all right first. Rather unlike Cowans, who's not renowned for being a dirty player at all. That was certainly a rash tackle then, and he will be receiving a caution from David Allison, who's reaching for the notebook, and I think that's going to be a yellow card. Indeed it is, for Gordon Cowans. Here it is once more, Putney caught by Cowans.
As you say, most unlike Gordon Cowans. He's got, normally you'd reckon Gordon to have the ideal temperament in a game like this, and his experience is going to be important. If you look at the respective sides, Villa have got players that have played in the big matches. Spinks, European Cup final, Cowans himself, Big Paul McGrath and Mountfield have both played in cup finals and so forth. Nielsen, a World Cup player. Whereas if you look at the most of the Middlesbrough side, the highest they've played, I would guess, or the most important games, were their playoff games of 2 years ago, and they are a very, very young side. So it's going to be a big test of their nerves tonight, Peter.
Well, they have a problem here with Trevor Putney, who's been out for a while with injury and only just come back. Just to remind you, Middlesbrough leading from the first leg with that dramatic last-minute goal from Mark Brennan. Trevor Putney, who's coming to replace Brennan, I wonder if he's going to be fit to continue. Chris Ryok looking on from the sideline with Colin Todd. Colin Todd, who was responsible for Colin Cooper being out of the side through injury, he apparently tackled him in training. Cooper has failed to make the side. So the substitutes warming up.
The nice thing about that incident, wasn't it, Peter? We understand that Tuddy was supposed to have said, once you've got it, you never lose it.
The old magic sponge. Will it do the trick for Trevor Putney, former Ipswich and Norwich player? And it was certainly a late tackle and a very untidy one from Cowans. And I think the referee will want Putney either to resume or be taken off for further treatment very shortly. Look on. What a marvellous night this is for Middlesbrough. And certainly if that tackle underlined one thing, it's that Villa mean business tonight. They're as determined to reach Wembley as Middlesbrough are. Trevor Putney, who's a wholehearted performer, and he will certainly want to continue, but for the moment it looks as if he's being helped off now. Trevor Putney clearly in trouble and being helped off the field. So that's a real setback for Middlesbrough. Already without Mark Brennan, and now Putney is off the field too. No sign yet of a sub coming on, so they're hoping obviously to rectify the situation pretty soon. Away cup Villa. Here's Platt. In the skipper's role then tonight with Gray out. Good interception then by Kerr. Proctor to sweep the ball back to Pears in the Middlesbrough goal. Proctor, another who gave such a sturdy display at Villa Park. It really was a marvellous team performance from them. And McGrath let it run through, obviously confident that Spink was behind him. Here's Gage. Here's Cowans. Gives it away though to Proctor. And Villa looking a little tentative in the early stages. Good tackle though by Nielsen. Daly. Parkinson having to keep such a careful eye on him. Still Daly whipping over the cross. And there we saw Ron there the pace and the menace that Daly obviously poses.
That's right, and obviously the reason why Graham Taylor's played him on the left wing to start with anyway. He's a right-footed player, has good pace, and his natural ability is to run inside. His inclination is to run inside, and Nielsen's played him in with a smart ball, and his pace has nearly taken him clear of Parkinson.
Now, a sub is coming on for Putney. There's the Aston Villa team, just to underline that Price is playing and not Gray, as we inadvertently told you at the start. Now Proctor, roared on by the crowd, straight though at Gage. Mowbray's header, Slaven lost out, good play here by Platt. No way through though for him, Slaven. Now then for Ripley. Gage got back at him well. Here's Daly, trying to shake off Parkinson, who's sticking to him so tightly. And it's Owen McGee that they want to bring on, Middlesbrough. Over on the far side. So Putney clearly is going to take no further part in this game. What a sad night for him. But on comes young Owen McGee, who let nobody down at Villa Park. Got stretched once or twice by the pace of Daly. I wonder where he's going to slot in now. Very versatile player. 10 minutes gone, no score. A fairly frenetic opening sight. Opening few minutes, and that is a third sight here of Trevor Putney being carried away on the stretcher. And he has, we understand, a damaged shin from that tackle from Cowans.
Yeah, that's a blow for Bruce Rioch's team, because actually with the absence of Mark Brennan as well, it leaves them without too many specialist midfield players. I feel sure if they'd have been chasing the game, if they'd have needed goals, Peter Davenport would have come on instead of young McGee. But basically, they're very, very short of natural midfield players now.
And McGee has slotted into Putney's role on the right-hand side of midfield. Outfield chasing here, pursued by Ripley. Ripley, one of the front two with Alan Kernaghan. Stuart Ripley. Just to remind you, there's no away goals rule tonight, so it's all set along the score. And at the moment, it's a one goal advantage from the first leg that Middlesbrough have. And for Trevor Putney, I'm afraid this game is over. Parkinson with a long ball, too long though for Kernaghan.
Yeah, that's presented a little bit of a problem for the Boro at the moment, is with the wind at the backs, they're tending just at this moment in time to overhit. Whereas last week, a feature of the game was the quality of the ball they played into their front players.
So often they found Ripley and Slaven too and Kernaghan in that first meeting at Villa Park when they really raised their game, Middlesbrough. And certainly in the second half, no doubt at all, they were in charge. And it was no surprise when they finally won the match with Brennan's last gasp winner. Paul Kerr, former Aston Villa man. Here's Proctor. Graham Taylor certainly was full of praise for the Middlesbrough performance in that first meeting, but feels his team can do a lot better. And is certain they will tonight. We shall see. Here's McGee. Throw though to Aston Villa. Owen McGee, one of the young players, being brought on and nurtured by Bruce Rioch at Ayresome Park. Only missing out. Mowbray, too long though for Kernaghan. Mowbray again, pumping it forward. And again, a somewhat wayward through ball.
Yeah, I think the wind and the nerves coupled together are playing a big part at the moment. Neither side's really settled into a pattern. Difficult conditions, the wind swirling all over the place.
We were actually talking with Bruce Rioch beforehand, one and I, and he kept telling us he wasn't nervous, but I'm sure he is, and it's such a big night for them, isn't it?
Very much so. I mean, it puts the icing on the cake for their season, doesn't it? I mean, Villa have got two or three more things to go at. Well, certainly a couple of other things to go at if they get a if they go out tonight.
You had a go at his sandwiches, didn't you? Have you brought some with you? Bruce Rioch holds a plate load of sandwiches and won't polish most of them off before the kickoff. It's a very cold night, but we're well protected up here. As indeed we were at Villa Park in that very rain-swept first meeting. Parkinson with a throw then for Middlesbrough. No score yet. If it stays this way, Middlesbrough will be going on to Wembley. Proctor. This is Kerr. Now then for Ripley. Didn't find Slaven though. But the wind held up the clearance from downfield. Proctor in the heart of it all in midfield. Rather untidy, Ormondroyd. Here's Olney. Middlesbrough competing for every ball, giving absolutely nothing away.
Yes, that's right, I think. And McGee will have probably come on with instructions to just scamper and scurry and put people under pressure and generally make life difficult for members of the Villa midfield.
Ormondroyd on. Olney. This is Gage. Easily cleared though by Mowbray. Off goes Kernaghan. McGrath. Cool and composed at the back. And of course, one of the most accomplished players in the Football League. No goals tonight. Middlesbrough leading 2-1 from the first leg at Villa Park. You're watching this match live on Sky. It's the Northern final of the Zenith Cup. The winners to go on to Wembley. And in the final, they play either Chelsea or the winners of the Southern semi-final, Swindon and Crystal Palace. They've yet to play. The match going on tomorrow night, so we should know then who Chelsea will meet to decide the other half of the draw. Mountfield. Taking the free kick then for Aston Villa. Ormondroyd hoping. Nielsen has gone forward too here. He got the header on. Away by Proctor. Finds Slaven. Leading goal scorer. For Middlesbrough, 23 goals from Slaven. One, of course, at Villa Park. And he scored again on Saturday in their 2-0 home win over Portsmouth. Paul Kerr getting the other goal. It's a clumsy clearance, and he might have got his fellow defenders in trouble then. I think the wind played a part. Spink quickly forward, finding Ormondroyd. Controlled it well. Couldn't get away from Mohan though. It does look a very useful defender. Equally happy at left back as he is in the centre of the back for Mohan. Proctor with a header. Been around a bit, of course, Mark Proctor, his second spell with Middlesbrough. And hoping that he can be in the side that goes on to Wembley. Middlesbrough unbeaten at home in any cup competition this season. Is the luck going to stay with them tonight? Parkinson, there's McGee outside him here. Now Ripley. Guerrero is with him. He's done well here, Ripley. Now McGee. Oh, just too long then for Kerr. It might have been Kernaghan or one of the other taller players in the side. That could have been interesting indeed. More promising then. Kerr, who's not the tallest of players, unable to reach the cross.
Good little spell for this at the for Middlesbrough at the moment. They're pressurising. They're not really being able to play the the neat and tidy football they like to. As I said earlier, mainly due to conditions, I feel, but they're certainly setting the stall out now, putting the Villa under some pressure.
And they're the record for the two teams in cup competitions, 6 wins each, Middlesbrough and Aston Villa. Proctor, seeing plenty of the ball in midfield, Mark Proctor. Just too far for Slaven. Here's McGrath. But so far, most of what attacking play there has been has come from Middlesbrough. Bruce Rioch emphasised his team wouldn't sit back and defend. They would go out to win this one tonight, not just settle for the draw, of course, that they need. Proctor, turned away from Cowans. Seems to have got to step up the pace. It's Middlesbrough now who had the throw, which Parkinson is preparing to take for them. Ripley, trying to shake off McGrath. What a confrontation they're having again. And the free kick is awarded to Middlesbrough. It's a throw taken by Parkinson, looking for Ripley. McGrath was in there first. It's Parkinson again. Slaven, Kernaghan. Now Slaven. Here's Kerr. Good turn by him. Can he finish here? Exemplary goalkeeping by Nigel Spink. But Kerr almost creating a chance for himself there.
Yeah, good work from Slaven and Kerr there. Kerr showing that, you know, he started as a centre-forward, and he shows his natural forward talent there.
And the shot well held by Nigel Spink. 20 minutes gone, still no score in the second leg. Middlesbrough 2-1 up from the first game. Price with the cross. Well held by Stephen Pearce.
Yes, I think Graham Taylor's obviously said, all right, we won't go crazy, we won't try and pull the game back in the first 5 minutes, we've a long way to go, let's just make sure we don't do anything daft, give anything away and stick at the game. Okay, if they get something in the first half, fine, but I think he's going to prepare, if the game stays like this, to come in with a grandstand second half.
If Villa get one back and it goes to extra time, then we will have to settle it on penalties if it isn't decided then. So there could be a dramatic night ahead here. With the free kick for Middlesbrough. They've started confidently enough, holding Villa for the moment anyway. Price with the header. Here's Olney. Now Platt riding the tackles, they were there. Orban Roy. Daly's in the middle. And Olney was on the two. He's forced the corner.
Just thinking how well Middlesbrough had done 25 minutes and Villa haven't had one of their dangerous set situations.
Let's see what they do from the corner here. Cowans to take it. Mountfield has come up from the back. And McGrath. And Nielsen. So there's plenty of height in there with Orban Droy too, of course. Got a flick on then from Nielsen. Cowans beaten though by Proctor. And has the danger passed. Price with the throw, Ormond Droy. Tall, lanky figure. He's given it away to Kerr. Sweeping it out now then to McGee. Nice touch, and he's changed the direction here well. Now Parkinson. Here's Ripley. Kerr, the Proctor has got a lot of space here. Now, can he open up Villa? Took a deflection. And safely from Villa's point of view. From McGrath back to Spink. But Proctor on, very much involved in the early stages.
Yeah, well, there's a lot resting on him. The senior midfield player in the side, the one with the most, shall we say, defensive qualities.
Just look here as Orban Droy sprints away, but his run was covered well by Mohan.
I'll have to go a bit against Mohan. Mohan's got some good pace. He showed that in the middle of the defence last week, didn't he?
He played so well then that Tony Mowbray, who of course was suspended for the first leg, said, well, I won't be surprised if the boss doesn't pick me this time, but I don't think Boro had any doubts that he'd bring back his captain, who's been such a stalwart defender for Middlesbrough down the years. Kerr's pass to Slaven, good tackle though by Price. Now Ormondroy. Wants to take them all on. Ripley, McGrath with the tackle. It's furious stuff out there. A real cup tie atmosphere. And McGrath just trying to calm things down. A long, long way to go yet. On from Olney. Foot was high. Free kick to Middlesbrough. I think we'll be fairly satisfied with the way it's going at the moment. Graham Taylor, the Aston Villa manager, will want to see even more urgency from his side. Mowbray taking the free kick. I think it's swirled in the wind.
Yes, but I would think Graham's quite happy at the moment. They've restricted Middlesbrough a little bit, and I think that he'll be looking, if he's going to start permitting people forward, that'll be as the game draws on. I would think if it's staying like this with 20, 25 minutes left, then you'll see the cavalry come out, I think.
McGrath. Parkinson just in before Daly, but here's Cowans. Playmaker, when he's allowed to be. He's held back then, surely, by Proctor. Free kick to Aston Villa. To be taken by Mountfield eventually. Again, looking for the towering figure up front of Ormondroyd. Olney and Platter up there too. Here's Ormondroyd. Didn't find Olney. McGee was in quickly. And that's going to be a corner. Rather recklessly cleared then by McGee. The ball caught by the wind, and it'll be a corner that will be taken by Cowans. That's a signal for McGrath to come up from the back. And Mountfield. And Nielsen. Nielsen on the near post, on the edge of the six-yard area. Cowans taking the kick. And Pears making the safe catch. 20 minutes of the first half to go. He looked very sound in the first game, Ron.
He did very well, Stephen Pears.
Play you know well, of course.
Yes, that's right. I sold him here, that's right. And he looked very competent and confident in his handling there. Just looking at Cowans on the corners there, he doesn't seem to be taking in swingers, and I'm just worrying on that side of the field where the advertising hoardings are a little bit tight for him to get a run up to take them off.
Well, might be one of ours, Ron, so we won't mention it. Eric McGee. Parkinson pumping it forward in search of the front players, Kernaghan and Ripley. Parkinson again. It's McGrath with Mountfield. Just too long for Olney. Way by Coleman. Kerr battling then with David Platt. And of course, 19 goals so far. First Division's leading goal scorer, David Platt, on this very windy night in Middlesbrough. Aston Villa will be looking for some more magic from him. They've been eagerly awaiting this one on Teesside for some time. Well, Peter With, down there in the studio, in the walk from the studio, though I think the window's went in earlier, but they've been replaced, I see. So, Peter, how are you enjoying this first half? What are your feelings on the way it's gone?
Well, to be fair, I think that the conditions, really, the wind is playing a big part. I think that it is a question of both teams are feeling each other out. Middlesbrough are not really chasing the game as much, and I think that I think Ron's right. I think the second half, with the wind behind them, Villa will be pushing all out.
And are the windows back?
Yes, the windows are finally back in, but we're still freezing in here. Don't worry about it.
Kernaghan now then for Middlesbrough, beaten by McGrath. Cowans. Service though isn't good enough for Olney. Aston Villa not really as yet carving out any genuine openings. Slaven, off goes Platt. Now can Villa get something started here? Ormondroyd has lost out. midfield. Middlesbrough chasing every cause, as you'd expect, so much at stake for them, as indeed there is, of course, for both teams. Roman Droid had to stretch. He did well there. Now, it's so hard to dispossess. Kerr managed it. They don't manage then. The tiny figure of Kerr and the giant beanpole figure of Ian Ormondroyd. So much an improved player, though, from earlier in the season when he was jeered and heckled by the crowd. Now they love him at Villa Park. Free kick to Middlesbrough. Mohan to take it. Outfield with the clearance, and he's found Ormondroyd. Some composed defending from him. Reassuring figure at the back. Nilsson was in well. Caught then from Rocto, who came flying across. Fair tackle though. And Kent Nilsson took the full brunt of it.
Yeah, that was a tremendous piece of competitive play by Mark Proctor. Just thinking there, I think Kernaghan and Ripley have got to realise the fact that they're not going to get a perfect service tonight and have probably got to work a shade harder.
Well, Daly's working hard for Aston Villa here, and Kerr tracked him back, warmly applauded by the crowd.
They've probably got to work a little shade harder just to make, shall we say, bad balls into good balls, because the service isn't going to come through perfect. It's not going to be anything like it was last week.
McGrath was it before, Ripley again, now Daly. Cowan's trying to get Gage away down this left flank. Just kept it in play. But beaten by McGee. Middlesbrough 16th in the second division. Aston Villa, of course, second in the first. But last season, the two of them were battling it out for relegation, or to avoid relegation in the first division. Villa succeeded and Middlesbrough didn't. Quarter of an hour to go in the first half, still no score in the second leg. So Middlesbrough, by virtue of their 2-1 win at Villa Park, have 1 foot on the coach to Wembley. Daly. Now Gage. Good running by Ormondroyd. Cut out there by Mowbray. They give it nothing away at the back, Middlesbrough. Looking pretty tight so far. Olney. And Cowans. Daly. McGee guiding it back.
Well, they're just getting a greater measure of control of the game, Villa, at the moment, than they've had for, well, they've had for since the start. Still no threats really on either goal, though.
Ripley with McGrath. McGrath was it bravely. Mowbray beaten in the air by Olney. Behind him was Simon Coleman. Player who's come in on leaps and bounds, Simon Coleman, since joining Middlesbrough back in October as a replacement, really, for Pallister. Pallister, of course, now with Manchester United.
See, that's the problem front players have. They wait for the ball to drop down, it's swirling all over, and don't forget, you know, they've got to have a perfect touch, they've got to be creative, whereas defenders can just whack the ball away if necessary. Very difficult game for forward players, I would guess, today.
Here's Platt, beaten by Kerr, who's fighting tirelessly for every ball. Platt was fighting too hard there. Kerr wants to get on with it. Sporting handshake. Platt, no doubt, the offender there. Kerr having another stormer for Middlesbrough. Here's the free kick. Looking for Ripley, McGrath away. Going as far as McGee. Now then for Slaven. Always danger when he's in possession around the penalty area. Outfield hooked it clear. Not very effectively though. Here's Kernaghan. Now then for Kerr. Coleman with Olney. Held up well then. hands rather hopefully forward. Sergio Borman draw it. Back with a header. Now, here's Olmi. Playing his way forward. Daly. And McGee was in there again. He's settled in very quickly.
Yeah, just looking at that lad there. He looks as if he's come on no nerves at all. He's just going to enjoy the occasion.
Certainly is relishing his cup tie at Ayresome Park. Mountfield's header. He found Ormondroyd. Here's Olney. The two who've linked so well along with Platt in recent months. Too long though for Price.
That was a bit unlucky, and I think it's virtually the first time a Villa defender has stepped out to try and carry the fight. And that's something I was saying, that's something I'm convinced the second half you're going to see plenty of.
Well, we expect it to be a very tight game, and so it's proving. Just a one goal between the two teams. And all the way back to Spink. Daly beaten in the air by Parkinson. There's Cowans. Parkinson again. And then just a flick from Proctor. Olney didn't use an arm. Referee waving play on. Daly to Gage. Just a hint now that Villa beginning to string some passes together. A point though from Gage. Kernaghan. Here's Proctor. And Platt chasing back. Where's he going? David Platt for the extra responsibility then of leading Aston Villa tonight. 10 minutes to half-time. No score in the second leg. Middlesbrough, just to remind you, leading 2-1 from the first leg at Aston Villa. McGrath, I think, has the pace to Spink. Victor is most alert. With Kernaghan lurking. McGrath so quick at the back. Mountfield. Olney. Ball hanging in the air then. On the wind. Slaven. There's McGee up in support. Ripley, Kernaghan down the middle. Again it was McGrath in. Daly. Produces acceleration here, away from Coleman. Still Daly, they're trying to bring him down. At the end, off Bohan for the corner. He does possess extraordinary pace. And Middlesbrough was struggling there to keep up with him.
That was almost a sensational goal. That's him at his best, actually. Just wondering at half-time whether Graham switched the two flank players over and go back to their more orthodox positions.
It's a corner then to Aston Villa. Again, the central defenders have come up from the back. Cowans again. Looking on the near post for Nielsen. Haven't got it away yet. It's another corner. Mowbray having to marshal his troops.
They've probably had more problems tonight, Middlesbrough, from the corners that have been taken than all of last first leg.
It's Cowans who's floating them on. Hopefully, anyway, from his point of view, on the head of Nielsen on the near post. Or there, Ormondroyd coming in, towering over everybody. He's 6'4", and he couldn't keep his header down.
The other thing, of course, just watching that corner there, Peter, everybody's so obsessed with the big boys that Platt has got himself here. You might just see it in the corner of your screen. Now, Platt is completely you just can't see it. Platt was completely unmarked, about 3 yards off the line, and that's a position where he's actually scrambled a lot of second balls. I've seen him score about 4 this season from touch-on headers, and he just scrambles it over the line.
He's been in such prolific goal-scoring form, of course. And one of the most successful players in the country at this stage. And he forced his way into the England reckoning. 2 caps, Italy and Yugoslavia. Here is David Platt. Can he lift Villa now? Grass header. Kernaghan. The full go for Ormondroyd. Olney. And Cowans. It's a good ball from him then. That surely was a foul. Referee waving play on. Price seemed to me to be held there.
Oh, how did he get so effective? I actually thought the referee had whistled, but twice Chris Price has done what he's good at, and that is made breaks from deep positions. And when he comes, he, because basically he's a very much like an old-fashioned outside right when he gets forward.
There was certainly danger there for Middlesbrough. He survived it. And here's Slaven now. 7 minutes to half time. Still 0-0. Kerr. Good play by Kerr and towards Slaven. It was Price who only half cleared it. Proctor. Oh, is that a corner? Yes, he's there for it. First half, Mark Proctor's out. There's the bugler employed by Middlesbrough. Can't quite hear him at the moment above the noise of this crowd. He's playing a really beautiful tune. He plays a bugle every time Middlesbrough attack, apparently. But he's fun to stand next to. Somebody's just told me to say, let's hope he's not playing the last post at the end. I didn't want to say it. Here's Kerr. Charge down. That was Coleman's shot. Oh, Daly's in the clear here. If Mowbray missed his tackle, but he timed it perfectly. Daly almost in the clear there. Yes. Ray to the rescue.
Yes, to be fair, he's looked the biggest threat at the moment. He hasn't quite made it, but on one or two occasions, he's looked very lively, very bright, and obviously his pace is phenomenal.
McGrath. Here's Platt. Now he's away from Owen. Albright's in the middle. Daly could find him with the cross. Another corner.
Which I don't think Mowbray's very happy about. He could actually have kept the ball in play, and he thought it was automatically assumed it was a goal kick.
It isn't. It's another corner. Owen's all right. Daly beginning to sparkle now as we near the end of the first half. Again to chip one in. A little longer this time, though. McGrath. That was close then.
I think that was a lot closer than people think. I think he was about an inch from pushing the ball past Bears in it.
Only needed a touch from Olney, who stayed onside as McGrath hooked it over the top. And he was only inches away. First half to go. It's looking good for Middlesbrough at the moment. They make it to half time. They're only 45 minutes away from Wembley for the first time in their history. Good effort then from McGee. He's on to the man of the match award.
Tremendous shot. I must admit, I didn't think there was anything like that on. I thought he was going to have to play another passing.
Showing so much confidence. Left footed drive. Post.
Funnily enough, he's one of the players, perhaps because he didn't realise quite how important the occasion is, that the nerves don't seem to have got to. He just seems as if he's just taking it as in his stride.
Cowles looking to find Daly, but he fails to do so. That's a throw to Middlesbrough. Ripley. Harassed by Mountfield. Stuart Ripley, some persevering up front, hoping for an opening.
I think that's the key word for front players tonight, Peter, perseverance. Trying to make something out of nothing and just chasing lost causes.
It's a free kick to Middlesbrough. First 45 minutes with a flourish. Parkinson to take the kick. Slaven among the players looking to benefit from the service here. So is Coleman. He has Proctor here and Kerr in space. Good call then by Kerr. Platt, can he bring it away for Aston Villa? He would have done. Drop down, free kick to Villa.
Kerr's looked the most likely to score, hasn't he? That's about the third shot he's drilled on target. All right, hit a defender in the crowded penalty area, but he has looked as if he's a support player, as if he's quite capable of snatching a goal from the distance.
Paul Kerr, of course, who had five seasons at Aston Villa, without ever really establishing himself as a first-team regular. But he certainly is that at the moment for Middlesbrough, having had quite a spell out through injury. Now his price. Whacked away by Coleman, but it didn't really get anywhere near where he intended. And that shot spun away too. Kept in by Pears. McGee.
I must admit that frightens me to death when there's forwards around and somebody plays one of those back passes.
He found his target all right though. Grass header. Cowans trying to send Olney on his way. Obrey was in with the header. Now Proctor. Ripley. Got away from Nielsen. Well, oh, just too long over Slaven. Now into the last minute of the first half.
Just got the feeling that Middlesbrough have got an awful lot of defending to do second half. I could see Platy pushing up, maybe even McGrath pushing up into a central midfield position and really trying to turn the screw on to force this equaliser.
Yes, I think we're in for a terrific second half here. Stay with us. The match coming to you live on Sky. It is to decide who goes on to Wembley from the Northern final of the Zenith Cup. No goals tonight. Middlesbrough leading 2-1 from the first leg. And the referee again seeing nothing wrong. And it looks as if Middlesbrough, the second division side, are going to go on to a half-time break with that one-goal advantage still from the first leg. Ripley trying to take on McGrath. He just can't get away from him, though.
He's been the best player in the field at the moment, hasn't he, McGrath? Him and Proctor, probably. McGrath's been an absolute rock in there. Hasn't missed much in the air, and he's seen off the threat of Ripley, who, as we saw last week, was a very, very dangerous player indeed.
Graham Taylor, looking pensive, but giving nothing away from his look on the face there.
I would think he'd be quite happy. I would think he'd be fairly relaxed about it. His side haven't been in too much trouble, and he's got the licence now to say, let's go to the sound of the trumpets. Not the bugle.
I was going to say, not the bugle.
Don't mention the bugle.
What's going through this man's mind now, Bruce Real?
He'll be watching his watch and thinking, doesn't it tick slowly?
What happened to my sandwiches? We're now into the second minute of injury time in the first half. Parkinson, well found then by Proctor. We're almost at the end of the first half. Owen McGee. First time he's made a mistake since he's come on. So we'll allow him that one. Now has blown the whistle for the end of the first half, and Middlesbrough are 45 minutes away from Wembley. Tony Daly, his pace was so obvious towards the end of the first half. I wonder if he and his Aston Villa teammates can spring this game away from Middlesbrough in the second half. Stay with us, it promises to be quite 45 minutes to look forward to. In the meantime though, we're going to take a short break, and after that, right to left. Can they hold on to this scoreline and reach Wembley for the first time in their history? Or will Aston Villa transform things in the second half? It's a swirling wind now that Aston Villa have behind them at the moment, having to defend. Middlesbrough, as you heard, coming out to the sounds of the bugler. Ripley trying to get in, McGrath away. The bugler didn't look too happy. I hate to see Middlesbrough losing. This chat they were talking about, though, this Mr. Tree, didn't you?
Oh, him and his buzzsaw, yeah, he drives you up the wall. Also, they had a giant raccoon, if I remember, at the same stadium.
It's only now, then, for Aston Villa, powering his way forward and wide of goal. But I wonder if we're going to see Aston Villa take control of this game in the second half. Certainly didn't have too many chances in the first. They'll be looking to exploit the pace down the right of Tony Daly. The crowd here, nearly a full house, most of them right behind Middlesbrough. On the verge of making history. Gage was tightening his header. Gra was in before Ripley.
Yes, I think that's been the biggest problem Middlesbrough have had this evening. McGrath's absolutely dominated Ripley, and at the moment, when Peter's talking about people being apprehensive, I think those two up front, particularly Ripley and Kernaghan, haven't really inflicted themselves on the game the way they did at Villa Park.
Gage taking the throw, Ormond Roy. Olney.
It's also noticeable, Peter, that Daly's gone more onto his right-hand side of the field. Norman Royd has taken his more orthodox position on the left-hand side.
Well, that was the headgear we should have on tonight. That was nice and warm. It's a bit chilly up here now in the commentary box, but we're enjoying this cup tie and hope that you are too at home. All this resting on tonight. The winners will go on to Wembley. Daly now. Stretching defenders. It's a corner. Middlesbrough will strain every sinew to hold on to this lead. And it is a lead, remember, of course, 0-0 tonight, but 2-1 from the first leg. It's Villa's fans making themselves heard now.
I think they're a bit unfortunate there. I think that ball actually came off Daly's foot.
Well, the referee has decided it's a corner. There's Nielsen on the edge of that six-yard area. Cowans looking for Nielsen with the flick on. Got it clear. Now Cowans, who's given it away to Ripley. No chance of the counter-attack though, as the ball is guided back to Stephen Pears.
But I think you saw there, as Cowans got the rebound following the corner, I think you saw a very important situation where the Middlesbrough players and so forth came out in sort of lorry loads to try and prevent the cross being put in. They recognise the danger that Villa can cause when they throw the balls into the penalty box.
It's pretty tense out there and it's very windy too. Just look at that flag blowing there. Really blustery night upon Teesside. And what drama we're in for now. Can Aston Villa come back in the second half? Mountfield to take the free kick for them. Nielsen has come forward. We have to keep an eye out for him. Olney flicking on. Coleman whacking it clear. There's only Slaven upfield though. McGrath for once, rather misplacing his header. McGee in bravely. Cowans finding Gage. And in goes little McGee, battling for everything.
I think one important thing Middlesbrough have got to do this half is they've got to hold a nerve, that's for sure. And the best way of doing it from their point of view is they've played a game and a half now and the back four took, as I said, a very high defensive position and not allowed Villa too near their penalty box. I think they've got to have the strength and the mental courage now to do it again for the second half.
Here's Kerr. And Slaven with him here. Didn't find Ripley though, because McGrath again read the situation so well. Ripley now has got Mountfield across there with him. And a goal kick. Not a decision that is approved by the huge crowd behind the goal. But the decision in favour of Mountfield. It's a packed stand here. Indeed, the whole ground and the atmosphere, absolutely terrific. And no one here among this Middlesbrough following believes that they're not going on to Wembley. 0-0 tonight, 2-1 from the first leg at Villa Park. A real surprise, that one. Can they spring another one here tonight? Ripley was beaten by McGrath. Nielsen chased by Kernaghan. Spink could set Aston Villa off again. Nielsen with some confident defending. This is Mountfield. Rather careless though, picked up by Slaven. Kernaghan. A foul though by Ian Olney. Oh, on Kernaghan. Free kick to Middlesbrough. Edging their way towards Wembley. A match that means so much to them. It's the best chance they may ever have. It's Mohun here with the free kick. Tremendous noise around Ayresome Park. Olney turned well. Couldn't shake off Coleman though. He's given another determined display at the back. Here's Kernaghan. Proctor outside him. Now Slaven. Good play by Slaven. Away by Gage. But here's Mowbray. Just lost his footing momentarily. There to tidy up was Parkinson. Tony Mowbray and Stephen Pears, two players of vast experience. Can they help guide Middlesbrough on to Wembley? Mowbray threatened by Olney. Strong defending again though from Mowbray. We've seen Middlesbrough come so close to cup success in the past. The last time they were this close to Wembley, Middlesbrough was back in the mid-70s in the League Cup when they lost out a two-leg semi-final against Manchester City. I wonder if they're going to make it this time. Aston Villa, of course, will have other ideas. Their last Wembley appearance back in 77, also in the League Cup. Ormondroyd is a sex kitten, it says there. Not exactly sure what that means. And they need him to be more than a pussycat tonight. Free kick then. Can Middlesbrough take advantage here? Ripley up front for them. Kernaghan. It's Mowbray to take the kick. Gage couldn't clear it effectively. Here's McGrath. High up into that bank of supporters. And more pressure coming in then from Middlesbrough. Aston Villa, remember, have to score two. Fair to deny Middlesbrough that place in the final. They get one back, it'll have to go to extra time. Cowans didn't go very far though. Kernaghan. Now then for McGee. It's Gage taking the throw for Aston Villa. Still no sign yet of Villa unsettling Middlesbrough in the second half, Rob.
No, I must confess, I'm a little bit surprised. I expected to see David Platt move up into a more attacking role this half. But at the moment, he's just content to sit in his semi-right side midfield area. Whether that'll come later, I'd have to imagine it would if the score stays as it is and Villa start really chasing again.
McGrath underneath this one. Here's Ormondroyd. Now operating down that left flank. To so much effect in recent matches. Not quite so much so in the first leg at Villa Park.
Well, I think Bruce Rioch has done his homework there, Peter. He's making sure he can't turn and run at them, because he has got great pace.
He's so awkward to contain, isn't he? Slaven's got it back here for Middlesbrough. 10 minutes into the second half. McGee. Good play by him. Coleman is well forward. It's Price who managed to whack it clear. Kerr back in again. Price for Daly to chase. Mohun watching him all the way. It's Mohun taking the throw then for Middlesbrough. With every passing minute, Wembley beckons for Middlesbrough. Unless Aston Villa can raise their game now. Here's Platt. Off goes Ormondroyd. loping away. Only waiting in the middle. He can get a pass in. Cowans. Going again, setting himself up for the shot. And Kerr's well to save. Slaven now. Looking for Ripley. Nelson with a timely intervention. Daly. Now Platt. It was Price in an advanced role, but they failed to link up with him. At this stage, it's still looking very good for Middlesbrough. McGrath. Platt put a nudge on. Olney. Price seems to fetch this one. He can't get there. Shaking off Nielsen. Kerr is with him, taking over. Now Proctor. Another goal might just clinch it for Middlesbrough. Slaven. Threaded through for Proctor. Now here's Kerr. In towards Ripley and Kernaghan. Gage got to bring it away for Aston Villa. Mowbray missed it, so did Olney. Here's Coleman. Now Olney has it back for Aston Villa. He has Daly up with him. Support two from Ormond Roy. Again, it comes to nothing.
I think what Villa are missing is the fact that people like Olney, is a fellow that likes to hold the ball up. Now, when he's doing that, people like Platt and people like Price, people that run from deep midfield positions, have got to really come bombing on. And at the moment, that has not happened. Hasn't happened often enough for Villa to build up any real momentum.
Not giving you any more cough sweets. Away by McGrath. We did actually ask for Rowan Atkinson, the summariser tonight, but Ron turned up. Proctor through. Good defending then. Sorry, Ron.
Sorry, I've got the teeth back in.
Another long kick upfield, headed on by Ormondroyd. And Olney won't reach that one. Are they hoping now, these Middlesbrough supporters, that last success is coming their way? They're getting nearer and nearer now. Let's remember, from a side lying 16th in the second division, Middlesbrough, against Aston Villa, in second from the top in the first division. Right up there alongside Liverpool. Middlesbrough down there, well, I think a much better side than that position might suggest. Stephen Pears, who's reclaimed his place as first-choice goalkeeper after a spell out through injury, quite a long spell too. But he's come back and, my word, he's performed well in these two matches. That was almost a slip the lid only in. Mowbray. Kerr with a header. Villa got into a bit of a tangle. A little lucky to get away with that. But Daly can't reach the through ball. It's Kerr. No one is full harder than him. Effective tackle though by Platt. Now here's Daly. Can he get away from Coleman? That'll be a free kick to Middlesbrough. But again, Coleman showing his value.
Absolutely brilliant recovery tackle that, because as we all know, Daly's a real flyer. And he was running the risk of bringing him down, but a very, very clean professional tackle.
Here's the free kick, taken by Mohan. Away by Nielsen, Proctor in the game. On then from Ripley, now then to Slaven. Slaven going on, oh, brought down there by Platt. Slaven. Very unlucky and furious with a tackle from Platt. Slaven, who's just been called up by the Republic of Ireland. Jack Charlton has been very impressed by his recent displays. He hasn't played Scotland, who also wanted to choose him at some stage. But the Irish have got it first. And Slaven was almost through then. But there's a real threat to the Villa goal here. Proctor is there. And Kerr and Parkinson. We know that he can drive a ball. Here's Parkinson now. Blocked by Gage. That hurt. Mowbray. The ball again holding up in the wind. Left it clear though by Mountfield. The front of him of the heart says Mowbray almost gave it back to Daly. Here's Mowbray. Cowans, McGee. Able to steer it back to Parkinson. Kernaghan beaten in the air. Gage hops it forward. But Mowbray is there yet again. They really have looked very sound at the back, Middlesbrough. Mowbray and Coleman in the centre. Mohan and Parkinson on the flex. Kernaghan. Here's McGee. Kick to Aston Villa. That's all the scores from matches being played in the Leyland DAF quarterfinals, which will also be featuring in terms of the final on Sky. We'll be bringing you the final. Brentford 1, Bristol Rovers 1, Tranmere Rovers 2, Chester 0. Those later scores. Going to be held at Wembley. And I wonder which of these two teams will be going on to contest the final of the Zenith Cup. And watching this match live on Sky, there's no score in the second half of the second leg. Middlesbrough are still leading courtesy of their 2-1 win in the first leg of the Villa Park as Ripley shoots over the bar. Ron, you had a gut feeling at half time that Villa were going to turn it round, but indication yet that's going to happen.
No, and all credit to Middlesbrough. I mean, they've come out, they've... Peter Withe was saying, actually, sometimes it's easier to play into the wind. The ball doesn't over... You don't overhit the ball, and that's happened in many occasions this night. But there's still, you know, we're talking about Wembley, there's still a long way to go yet.
As Bruce Rioch, watching from the sidelines, will know. He'll be having a few anxious glances at his watch as the second half wears on. Slaven turned away from trouble. Here's McGee outside him. Still McGee. Given back to him. Now Slaven, who was onside. Kernaghan in the middle, didn't reach him. McGrath is still down injured. Beaten then by Mohan's sliding tackle. Free kick to Middlesbrough, and I think McGrath may need some treatment before he can go on. I wonder also if Graham Taylor may be thinking anyway about a substitution one.
He certainly wouldn't be bringing this big fella off. He's been his best player. He came off at half-time in the first leg, and we were led to believe that that was a knee problem. And looking at it, it looks as if it's recurring now. That would be a big blow for them.
He has Birch and Gray as a substitute, so technically, if he was thinking well...
Yes, I think he'd probably bring Gray on and play him as an orthodox left-field back.
Paul McGrath, who's stunk so well for Aston Villa since his move from Manchester United, when it seemed his career might be over, it most certainly isn't. There is Stuart Gray, the club captain, in fact, at Aston Villa, but left out of the starting lineup tonight with Chris Price preferred. McGrath back on his feet. Much to the relief of Graham Taylor, he's able to resume. 20 minutes into the second half. Parkinson with the free kick then for Middlesbrough. Here's Kerr. Mowbray. Parkinson again. Now Ripley. Here to pin Aston Villa back. Can they find a second goal? Linesman flagging furiously over the far side. I don't think the referee has seen him. Now the Villa players are pointing over to the linesman. And David Allison is indicating to his colleague that he has notice his flag, but he's given the decision to Aston Villa anyway. Well, Peter Withe, watching from the studio down there, what do you feel about Villa's performance in the second half? They haven't yet taken a grip on it, have they?
No, I was just thinking really what Ron said really is that I was thinking that they were going to change and maybe push Pratt up front and then play Paul McGrath in midfield, but I think that he'd be weakening it because he's really been their best defender really. And when he got injured I thought, well, maybe he'll change it now, but I think that I would have thought that he'll change it at some stage. He's got to try and get the goal, so I think he'll push people forward.
Well, let's see what Villa can do here. I think for the moment the throw given to Middlesbrough.
I think at the moment the biggest worry I would have if I was Graham Taylor would be the fact his side don't seem to have the drive. I mean, there they are, the 20 minutes or so away from Wembley. They haven't quite got the drive you would accept from them.
Certainly no lack of purpose about Middlesbrough, who are so close now then to their first ever Wembley final. We're halfway through the second half. No goals in the second leg, if you're just joining us. So Middlesbrough still 2-1 up from the first meeting at Villa Park. Ripley, now Slaven. Here's Kerr. Proctor tussling with Cowans. Away then by Mowbray. Kernaghan. Away by Mowbray. Still a tower of strength at the back for Middlesbrough. Gage now for Aston Villa. Ormondroy. Tackling was fierce, and it's a free kick to Villa for the foul on Ormondroy. Up comes Nielsen from the back, and Mountfield is making his way rather slowly forward too. McGrath has stayed back. It's Cowans with the free kick, got Olney and Ormondroy in there too. Middlesbrough will have to be on their toes, and Wigan really took that one then. And it sailed away to safety. There are so many tall players in this Aston Villa side, you fancy them to get on the end of one or two of these crosses. Here's the free kick from Cowans, and over everybody's heads, and over Stephen Pearce as well, as he straightens to reach it, and it's a goal kick.
Yeah, those are very, very difficult balls, of course, for the goalkeeper to judge, but they're also difficult for the kicker to put in accurately. I mean, Gordon Cowans hits those in as well as anybody in the game, and yet that's probably a really loose ball as far as he's concerned.
McGrath having to chase. Ormondroy.
Just right behind him on the edge. Just watching Big Paul McGrath chase after that one, Peter. He does look to be in some sort of trouble.
But as you said earlier on, there's no way they would want to take McGrath off. But here's Slaven now. Oh, Price, a very important tackle then. Here's McGrath, who does look to be in trouble. Perhaps it may be an enforced substitution, because Villa do look as if they want to bring on a sub. Ormondroy. Off goes Daly. How is his pace taking him in here? Oh, great save. Just managed to push it wide as Daly streaked into the penalty area. He was away from his marker, away from Coleman, and look at the save here as he stretched and pushed it wide. Cowans taking the corner, and here's the hero.
Absolutely brilliant save that, Peter. So impressive the way he stood and waited. He didn't commit himself, the keeper there. He stood and waited to see where Daly was going to hit his shot, and then he's made a very, very agile and acrobatic save. Wonder how important that might be at the end of the day.
It certainly will be. If Middlesbrough make it now to Wembley, they'll look back on that dramatic save from Pears. Made some fine stops in the first leg too.
It's also the first time this half that a Villa forward has been able to get clear.
Stuart Gray is coming on, and Ormondroy is going off. Ron, your thoughts on that?
Well, he's going to play left side. Platt's going to push up into the midfield, and push up into the front, and Gage is going to go into midfield.
Just as you speak, that's exactly what happens.
obviously McGrath is not as bad as we feared.
Well, he looked to be in trouble a few minutes ago, perhaps he's managed to run it off. But Ormondroyd is off and Stuart Gray on for Aston Villa.
Yes, I can see the value in that though, Peter, because really Ormondroyd hasn't been able to get rid of his defenders.
Nice kick then from Mountfield.
And Olney has had very little or no support up front. Now he's got Platt, and Platt will be, he'll be trying to drive the game over the last 20 minutes or so.
They really have got to upper gear now of Aston Villa. If not, then Middlesbrough will be going on to Wembley. That's the prize awaiting the winners here. It is the final of the northern area of the Zenith Cup. And it's Kerr with the free kick from Middlesbrough. Everything. Battle for every ball. Proctor then underlining the fact with his challenge. Parkinson, but only as far as Cowans. Slaven read the pass. Is he going to turn out to be the hero of the night? Let's look again at this. Incredible save by the goalkeeper. Daly showing his pace and Kerr's that magnificent reaction save. Coleman might have run into trouble then. Stuart Gray has popped up with some useful goals. Stuart Gray and Graham Taylor will be hoping that his substitution pays off as we move now then towards the final period of this game. From Gray, but the ball is out of play. It's a throw to Middlesbrough. Stuart Gray got a couple of goals from free kicks in the recent FA Cup win over Port Vale, and he was a consistent scorer for Barnsley in his spell there. I wonder what impact he's going to make now. Stuart Gray on for Ian Ormondroyd for Aston Villa. Bruce Rio trying to stay calm. I wonder what he's thinking now with his team so close.
I would think he's hoping that his team battle on as they battle for the half hour or so that's gone in this half. They've really done him credit over the 2 weeks, but now it's, you know, it's a test of mental strength. Can they keep working? Can they keep pressurising and not really let Villa build up ahead of steam, which they've done brilliantly, in fact.
They were so proud of their display at Villa Park, hoping they could repeat it again tonight. So far, it's all going to plan. Up towards Olney. Cowans was fouled by McGee. Price was calling for a cannonball for Lewis here, but Cowans was in no hurry. They've all come up from the back this time. McGrath, Mountfield and Nielsen. Here's Gage. Mistimed it completely.
Yes, I think that's so important for Middlesbrough now in this last 15 minutes or so that they don't concede free kicks or corners needlessly. I know it's difficult, I know it's a question of nerves, and sometimes you get a little bit anxious and start committing yourself for tackles that you shouldn't really go for, but it is so important, and that fellow there's very important. He's the one that's been in the mixer for a while now, Mowbray. He's the one that's got to drive and instruct to make sure that everybody stays on their stations and stays at their job.
Local man Tony Mowbray, who was so disappointed when Middlesbrough, the team he was supporting back in the 70s, failed to reach the League Cup final. Price trying to beaver his way forward. It's a throw to Aston Villa. Their supporters getting excited behind the goal. Quarter of an hour to go. Still 0-0. Middlesbrough are 15 minutes away from Wembley if it stays this way. Leading 2-1 from the first leg. Olney. He's forced the corner.
This is exactly what Villa want now, don't they? They can build up momentum, they can build up pressure on Middlesbrough. send all their big guns up and do what they're good at, that is these set situations.
Nielsen stationed on the edge of the six-yard area, looking for the nudge on. It's a packed penalty area. And a huge sigh of relief around Ayresome Park. They've been looking forward to this game for some time now. Certainly after the first leg at Villa Park. Came through a difficult match in the last round against Newcastle, a last-minute winner from Cooper. Are they going to survive this one? Mountfield now. Villa capped in the Middlesbrough half. Daly. And here's Kerr, of course, as always now, the threat of the counter-attack. Mountfield. Price drilling in the cross. Oh, and Pears had to tip it over the bar. More heroics from the goalkeeper.
Ripley's down there,
I think, yes. But here's the corner. The pressure's coming in from Villa now. Pears underneath it, and a goal! Stuart Gray. And Villa have equalised. We were talking about the danger from the set pieces. And from the corner, Aston Villa have equalised through Stuart Gray. Floated over by Cowans. Middlesbrough failing to clear, and it's just a little nudge in.
Yes, well, that's their speciality. What a substitution, particularly if it takes them all the way.
And from nowhere, Aston Villa have pulled it round. It's all square. And if it stays this way, we're heading for extra time. What a tie on now.
If we look at it again, if we get a chance to see the game, Peter, I think we'll see Stephen Pearce might feel he's very harsh. The judge not to get a foul there.
Well, now Middlesbrough have some more defending to do. Proctor has been booked, incidentally. Awful picture at the moment. And Villa are piling forward again. Cowans with the free kick. Here's Daly and Price. This time Middlesbrough are going to bring on Peter Davenport, and Stuart Ripley is going off. Peter Davenport, who's had his problems recently with injury, and a great round of applause for Stuart Ripley. Battled away gamely up front, and on comes the very talented Peter Davenport.
Yeah, it's also quite possible, looking at Ripley, he's off the field when they equalise, it's quite possible that he may have been back in one of those defensive situations. There may have been a man light in marking there. But now it's ironic that really this is the first real concerted pressure Villa have applied in the whole of the match.
So can Middlesbrough hang on now? We were talking about Wembley minutes ago, but now it's level again. Villa leading by a goal to nil on the night, and the aggregate scores are level at 2-2. Stuart Gray, the goal scorer, an inspired substitution by Graham Taylor. Here it is once again. Pick on there, and Gray, he get a nudge on Pears as well. Mohan, McGrath, Villa will be lifted now. It's a test of character for Middlesbrough. Having been in front for so long in this game, from that lead from the first leg, there are now 10 minutes left here. Extra time is looming. A few hard skip to beat then as Coleman's intended back pass almost fell for crap. Here's McGrath. Villa. Middlesbrough have got players forward here. Instead, it might come to something. Parkinson for Slaven to chase. Nielsen have gone over with him, but Slaven shrugging him off. In towards Kerr! Spick lost it. It's a goal kick. And Kerr was so courageous then.
He was courageous, and there's also suggestion he may have had a little bump like that as he went in by Price.
Aston Villa living very dangerously here. I think he may have given the foul now, the referee, although it appeared to be one from him.
He certainly wasn't foul.
But are we now going into extra time, or can one of these two teams find a winner in the last few minutes? Daly now. It was away from Mohan. There are three in the middle. And that is the unpredictable side of Tony Daly, Rob.
That's right, but I mean, Villa are playing now as the way we thought they'd play most of the second half. They're carrying the fight, they're pushing players forward, and they're trying to build up, as I say, a concerted momentum.
The goal has certainly stunned Middlesbrough. David Platt, the Aston Villa captain. Although Stuart Gray is now on the field, so perhaps he's taken over the armband. Gray, the club captain. Platt, the captain when this game got underway tonight. Parkinson now. Kernigan with the pass. Here's McGee. Too long, though, for the front players. Safe in the arms of Spink. Off come Villa again. Olney's header on. Of course, just to remind you, if it goes into extra time and they still can't settle it, then it's all down to penalties. Proctor. The Borough crowd urging Middlesbrough on. Proctor now. Here's McGee. Kerr and Slaven in the middle. Kernigan. Parkinson's cross, away by Price. Are Middlesbrough going to be denied that Wembley place after all? Well, there's some skirmishes going on out there now, and no one, of course, wants to make a vital mistake in the last few minutes. And who would dare bet where this one might go now?
I think if you were a betting man, you'd have to say the pendulum swung towards the Villa, only psychologically.
Mountfield with a free kick. Olney didn't jump. Slaven. Still time for either side to clinch it. He's out of play. It's a Villa throw. And there's definitely now fresh spring in the Villa stride. To the goal from Stuart Gray. Way by Mowbray. The wind brought it back again. Villa threatening to take control. But extra time now, a very strong possibility. Here's Davenport. He's had no real chance to shine yet. Came on as a substitute on Saturday at Davenport in the win over Portsmouth. Having been out through injury, wasn't available for the first leg at Villa Park. Off Mountfield for a throw to Middlesbrough. Five and a half minutes to go. Mohan taking the throw. Kernigan. Now then for Davenport. Powerfully away though by McGrath. But here's Mowbray. Parkinson now, driving the ball in, but straight at Cowans. Parkinson, who showed his shooting power in those FA Cup ties with Everton earlier in the season. Slaven now. Middlesbrough trying to press here. Oh, Daly got back well. The break is on. Daly skipping past one tackle, but not the second. Coleman comes over. What a finale for the Zenith Cup Northern final. Mountfield has a second chance. Elects instead to find Nielsen. Middlesbrough with almost everybody back. Kerr. Oh, he's given it away. Olney. Can he finish it here? That was all from Kerr's. Could have been so embarrassing and could have ended Middlesbrough's Wembley dream. But Olney was unable to take full advantage. What a let off then for Kerr at Middlesbrough. But it's another corner for Aston Villa. 4 minutes to go. Middlesbrough 1, Aston Villa 1. It's all square on aggregate. Fans looking to use the wind on these crosses and set pieces. Daly now starting to come into his own, and that's a good cross in. Only on Nielsen. Now then for Gray. Kerr able to scramble it clear. My word, they're hanging on here now, Ron.
Very much so, very much so. It's Villa in the driving seat. I should think Bruce Rioch's hoping they get to full-time very quickly and they can sort of calm his lads down and pass fresh instructions and try and inspire them to go the last half an hour of extra time to take them through to Wembley. But at the moment, it's looking Villa much the stronger side.
Cowan through. Kerr tackling with Cowan's. And the free kick goes to Middlesbrough. But Kerr so nearly gave it all away then. That'll be going through his mind now. He's had a terrific game for Middlesbrough.
He has indeed. Oh. There's a suggestion of handball here, only as he gets.
He was nearly brought down too, but here's Kerr out the other end. Paul McGrath with a saving tackle. If there's a better defender in the country at the moment than Paul McGrath, I certainly haven't seen him. Olney. Coleman with him, Proctor. There's no upfield for Middlesbrough here. Price. Is that a foul? No, Mohan. It was a good tackle. Kernaghan now. Proctor. 2 minutes to go. Parkinson now for Middlesbrough. Can they steal it now? Here's Slaven. Davenport. Kerr taking over. Just over the bar. And from almost giving a goal away at the other end, Kerr so nearly snatched it then for Middlesbrough. Well worked move at my Middlesbrough. Kerr taking it off Davenport and firing just over the top.
Yeah, it's a little move they've done once or twice in the game with players. I think it's a thing Bruce and Colin Todd practiced a lot, a little takeover.
We're now into the last 90 seconds of this game, and it's Olney now chasing forward for Villa. Good tackle by Coleman, and that was crucial. It's a Middlesbrough throw. Didn't go down too well with the Villa fans behind the goal. But as we go into the last minute, it's drama right to the end here. And just to remind you, we're into extra time if they can't settle it in the last 60 seconds. It's a Villa throw. Mountfield to take it. Trying to find Platt, it's Mowbray heading away for another corner to Aston Villa. And Mowbray has some more organising to do now. It's Cowans with the corner. Nielsen is in there and Olney on Mountfield. Daly forward. McGee, here's Daly. In towards Platt. Holding on.
I think it's also fair to say, Peter, in the last, 20 minutes or so, the wind has really got up. It's a lot more blowier now. They've got a much stronger wind behind them than the worst first half. And they're all credit to Villa at the moment. They're taking full advantage of it.
What will happen, I wonder, in extra time, if indeed it does go to that. It's looking more and more like it now. Slaven. Only seconds left. Price in before McGee. What a cup tie. Here's Olney. Cowan's threading it on. Too long for David Platt. Stuart Gray's goal has brought Aston Villa right back into this final. winners to go on to Wembley. And the referee has blown the whistle for the end of normal time. And the late goal from Stuart Gray has proved a lifesaver for Aston Villa. They've won this match tonight by a goal to nil. Middlesbrough having won the first leg at Villa Park by 2-1. And Stephen Pearce finally beaten by the header from Gray, but a marvellous save from him earlier on that seemed to be taking Middlesbrough on to Wembley.
They look stronger physically. They've at least got the advantage as well. They've got Graham Taylor still got one substitute he can put on. I think a lot depends there on what Bruce Rea can do in this little two-minute spell now. I mean, he's going to have to whip his players up and get them to believe in themselves again. They've worked so hard and gone so close. Now they've got to try and raise it again for this last half an hour, whereas Villa, if it'd been you, it would have been with it.
And the keeper.
If it'd been me or Ron, it wouldn't have been. Anyway, on we go then with extra time. I wonder what's going to happen now in the next 30 minutes. And of course, if they still can't settle it, then it's all down to sudden death with the penalties. Well, the Villa players were certainly looking rather relaxed as they were pepped up by Graham Taylor. And in the driving seat, really, from their storming finale to normal time. Cowans now. Villa still with that wind behind them. McGrath taking the throw himself. 15 minutes each way, of course. In extra time, Daly now. He ran straight into a sea of red-shirted defenders, though. Slaven. Turning one way, then the other. Proctor now. Against Davenport, away to his left here. Producing the vocal encouragement that Bruce Rioch had called for beforehand. Davenport now. It came off Mountfield, it's a corner. Great excitement here at Ayresome Park. There's nothing like a good old-fashioned English cup tie to stir the blood. And they're relishing this match here. It won't be the prize for the winner. Coleman has come up. And Mowbray too. Proctor's corner. McGrath to the rescue. McGee, Kernaghan, here's Davenport, in such good close control, useful cross too, here's McGee, didn't really get hold of it, appeals for handball, and the referee in no way interested. McGee has toiled away.
It's ironic really, I bet Bruce Rioch sitting there thinking this is the only major competition where away goals don't count double.
Yes, they'd have won it, of course, by virtue of their two goals at Villa Park. Middlesbrough throw. If you're just joining us, we're now in extra time in this Northern final of the Zenith Cup. The second leg. Villa leading by a goal to nil on the night, so it's 2-2, all square on aggregate. Ward Daly in here. Mohan's done very well again. Slaven here. Now Davenport. Kerr. Quite fine Slaven thanks to the sliding intervention of Chris Price. Mohan. Over the head of Slaven. Mowbray. Example he has been to his teammates tonight, Tony Mowbray, back after suspension, of course. Proctor now, it's Parkinson. Price, off he goes on one of his runs. Platt now, good pass from him. Too long though for Platt and Price coming in. Stuart Gray supplying the cross. And Wynn took that one way over the far side. Mountfield taking the throw for Aston Villa. Mowbray. Kerr taking over from Slaven. Skipping past. Two tackles. Gray now. That was down the middle, and Daly. It's Davenport breaking away from Middlesbrough. Now then to Slaven. He's got Kernaghan up in support. Through the middle. Cut out by McGrath. Proctor now. There'll be some tired legs out there. It's the survival of the fittest now. Proctor. And Kerr with him, and Parkinson here. Now Kerr. We've got two, three waiting in the middle. Whipped away though by McGrath. Good jump by Mowbray. Now Daly.
McGrath's playing as if he's got magnets in his feet, isn't he? Virtually every ball, every cross he's put in seems to be attracted to him.
Slaven. Price is only on then from Platt. Mowbray with a covering tackle. Daly almost embarrassed the pair of them then. But it's still all square in this Northern final of the Zenith Cup. You're watching live and exclusively on Sky. We'll be with you right through to the finish, of course. It may well go to penalties, but there must be a finish tonight. Someone has to go on to Wembley. Daly. Some room for himself, has he taken it too far? Still Daly, and eventually he was brought down by Davenport. So free kick to Aston Villa. Up goes Nielsen from the back. Still in the first period of extra time. Cowans, good cross. Platt's in there. Flags up for offside. Nothing will happen here now. The linesman waving furiously over on the far side. It was a moment or so ago, and it's offside against Aston Villa. Come on, Boro now, is the roar around Ayresome Park. Can Middlesbrough lift themselves again? Will Aston Villa go on to reach that Wembley final? Davenport. This is Cowans, now for Gray. Mowbray, only is it there, scattering and hoping. And the referee deciding in favour of Aston Villa. Player's not too happy. Only. 8 minutes gone in this first period. Gage setting himself up for the shot and drilling it well wide.
It's noticeable once Villa do go into the attack how quickly Mountfield steps out of the back line to go and join it up. Now he's got a nose for goals. He scored some very, very valuable goals in his career. Now I think he's looking to score one which would certainly be Villa's most valuable goal for years.
Seven goals this season from Derek Mountfield, and many more, of course, from his Everton days. The First Division's highest scoring defender this season. And they've had a great defensive record too, Aston Villa. They've conceded less goals in the First Division than any other side. Another player down injured, Proctor, I think. Here's Cowans. Now then for Stuart Gray. Here's Platt. That would have been a spectacular finish if he managed to get on the end of that one. Kernaghan is the target here. Turning away from McGrath. Nielsen pumping another one forward. Platt's onside. Daly's in the middle and only two. But they're looking a little tired at times now out there. Villa, of course, should have been fresher for this one. They didn't have a match on Saturday. Their game at Queen's Park Rangers was called off. Middlesbrough beat Portsmouth at home. So stamina will certainly play a part now. Extra time. First period to go. Parkinson with the free kick. The cross came from outfield. Now, is there a chance here for Middlesbrough? The bugler thought about bugling but didn't. Will he smile if they score? There's the cross in. Throw to Middlesbrough. Parkinson looking to hurl another long one in. McGee. Came off Gray. Just kept it in play. Northen centre. Now, the linesman, I think, may well have signalled a corner. Not too good a view of it away to my left. Referee has given the corner. Coleman making his way forward from the back. Mowbray too. It's a siege now on the Villa goal. Mowbray, Kernaghan, another corner. Again on Stuart Gray. The crowd wondering now if Middlesbrough can do it. It'll be Potter again with the corner. Mowbray. He is challenging. Davenport! And it's there from Slaven! Ernie Slaven has done it! And the crowd here have gone absolutely bananas. Ernie Slaven, goal number 24 for him this season. And he has put Middlesbrough back in front.
Peter, it's unbelievable. I couldn't help thinking when the ball previous, from the previous corner, had fallen to Kernaghan. Just thinking, would this one have fallen to Slaven? And there he is, seconds later. He really hasn't had a kick in the penalty box all night. And at the first chance, he shows what a sharp little finisher he is. When it's anywhere in the six-yard box, he's as good as anything in football.
He switched so well from the right foot to the left. Super finish from Slaven. And the crowd here celebrating now. Are they on their way to Wembley? Season he's having. That's number 24 then, his seventh in this competition. He of course scored at Villa Park. And the crowd now in tremendous voice. Bruce Rural, no emotion on his face. He knows it isn't over yet. Just a couple of minutes of the first period of extra time to go. McGrath for Aston Villa. Flat. Parkinson coolly steers it back. Well, Ron, they've turned it round again.
Very much so. I mean, it's ironic how little things change for you. I mean, there was play going on, and all of a sudden the linesman's given a corner that nobody else has quite seen, and how vital that could be to Middlesbrough's cause.
Well, they're delighted. I would like to see what the bugler's doing. Perhaps we will in a minute. McGrath with a throw for Aston Villa. Nearing then the end of the first period of extra time. Middlesbrough 1-1 on the night, leading from the 2-1 advantage from the first leg. There he is. Oh, he's blowing away quite cheerfully now. Has anyone told him they've scored, I wonder? Mowbray with a header. Pressing. Kernaghan. Now then to Parkinson. Aston Villa are right back in the game with a goal from Stuart Gray. Now Bernie Slaven. A long electrifying atmosphere at Ayresome Park. Cowans now for Aston Villa. They certainly haven't finished yet. Daly, even his sprinting ability, couldn't keep the ball in play. I bet she's seen a few matches down the years, Rob.
Well, she's only been going for the last 3 years. She's only 27.
I think we've all aged a few years tonight. That's half time. Middlesbrough back in front. Goal from Bernie Slaven. We were saying earlier on about his selection for the Republic of Ireland. So he's got plenty to celebrate at the moment. Here's the corner again and the goal. Proctor with the corner. Mowbray rather mistimed his jump, but still managed to hit the ball on. Then it was Davenport driving it through, and Slaven switching feet there delightfully and into the corner. It's a quality finish run.
That's reminiscent of a certain Jay Greaves, isn't it?
Very much so. Right on we go then with the second period of extra time. And what a tense, nail-biting 15 minutes this is going to be.
I think it's so important now for Middlesbrough, they've got the wind at their back, that they don't drop back. Don't drop back and sort of play the game from their own penalty area. They've got to try and play the game as deep into the Villa half as they can.
Cowans, beaten by McGee, and here's Stuart Gray. Away by Mowbray. Nielsen. Good running here by Price. He's made a lot of useful sorties down that flank. Goal kick. He didn't agree with the decision. Behind the goal, gave a huge roar of relief there. And how excited they all are. Well, they've seen some great days, some great matches at Ayresome Park, but never have they seen their team go on to Wembley. Davenport now. It's a free kick to Middlesbrough. Here's the free kick, looking for Kernigan. Nothing doing this time though. Peter With, how do you think it's going now?
Yeah, I was thinking in the first half really, the three centre-backs of Villa, they're covering the left-back position and they've pushed Stuart Gray forward, as far forward as they can now. And they had a great spell, and it was ironic really that I was thinking exactly the same as Ron, really, when the linesman must have good eyes to give a corner, and I was saying it's going to be ironic if they get a goal from this. And they did, all right, they took the corner again, but they got a goal from it.
Pass set from Cowans going astray. So a few more seconds ticking away. Andy Slaven, the man whose goal has Middlesbrough back in front overall. Aston Villa man, and he's given now Middlesbrough a two-goal advantage.
think anyone would begrudge him that, apart from a fanatical Villa supporter. He's worked hard, been very professional. He looked after David Platt in the first half. He probably had the most number of goal attempts. He nearly gave the game away with the back pass, and there it is. He may very well, as you say, have taken the distance now.
Aston Villa hoping to spring straight back with Platt here, and only if McGee tidies up. What a strike then by Kerr. So often a fringe player on Aston Villa. That's his reply. And the celebrations are going on wildly now around the stadium. Paul Kerr, I would imagine, can hardly contain his excitement. His first goal in the competition, he scored on Saturday. That was his first of the season. There are 10 minutes left. It's a mountainous task now facing Aston Villa. Two goals behind. Nielsen. Here's Olney. Tackling with Mowbray. Shaken him off. Rage. Certainly are thriving. aggregate. Aston Villa were ahead in the first game, remember, and they scored the first goal tonight. And yet again, Middlesbrough have come so defiantly from behind. Kernaghan losing out to McGrath. He's been quite magnificent for Aston Villa, but is he now going to be on the losing side? Slaven, scorer of the second goal tonight. Now Proctor. Here's McGee. Didn't find Slaven.
It's so important now for Middlesbrough, they don't give the ball away unnecessary.
It's Price with a through ball, Daly, and Piers may come all the way.
I think we just saw in that little incident there with McGee when he had several easy options on and he tried the hard ball. At this stage of the game, it's keep the ball, don't give it the opposition.
5 minutes to go. Cowans with Price. In towards Olney. Now Daly. Cowans too long for Mountfield. More good save again. Safe handling. Bruce Rowe with more instructions from the bench. Looking so calm and collected beforehand, Bruce, but everyone would be feeling inside.
Side, does he?
But unless something dramatic happens now, he's going to be. Middlesbrough with his two-goal advantage, and we're into the last 5 minutes. Four, in fact, to go now. Slaven and Kerr with the goals for Middlesbrough after Stuart Gray had levelled the tie overall. Celebrating this one for some time to come in Middlesbrough if they go on to Wembley. Pears just pondering a few more seconds. Kernaghan and Slaven to wait for up front. Nielsen with the header for Villa. Now Cowans. Can they come again? Middlesbrough, who rallied so well after the setback of losing Putney early on. Little Owen McGee has come on and produced wonders, really. Sterling display by him. And by all this Middlesbrough team, who are 3 minutes away from Wembley. Bruce Rioch will be so proud if they can't make it. Mountfield's throw. Kernaghan. It's a free kick to Aston Villa. Flat. They know how sharp he can be. Appeals for a penalty. Rejected by the referee, David Allison. Stuart Gray. Two other scores there. Brentford, this is the Leyland Daff. Brentford 1, Bristol Rovers 2. And Tranmere, I didn't catch the end of that one before it was removed from the screen. 3-0 the final score to Tranmere. Graham Taylor wondering what his team could do now. Into the last couple of minutes. Daly. Still persevering, still hoping, but it's looking beyond them now. But it is Daly. Away by Mowbray for the corner. And there still may be some anxiety for Middlesbrough before they catch that Wembley place. It'll be Cowans, of course, with the corner. Only Slaven has been left upfield for Middlesbrough. Here's the corner. Will McGee sliced his clearance. midfield. A minute left. Desperate defending by Middlesbrough. Kerr. Trying to shake off Mountfield. He is propped up. Now Davenport. Parkinson's gone through the middle. McGrath was there. Only seconds left now. Gage, hopefully forward. Whistles from the Middlesbrough fans. They know it's nearly over.
Just reward for a magnificent display of character, because if you look at over the two games, it's fair to say that Middlesbrough have been the better side. In the second period of normal time, I thought Villa had a really good spell. But overall, in the two games, Middlesbrough definitely deserved this.
Proctor. Price, now McGrath. We're now into time added on for any stoppages in extra time. There certainly haven't been many of those. Gray. Still Gray, going all the way. It's safely in the arms of goalkeeper Bears. No way through this time for Stuart Gray. It's all over! Have made it to Wembley for the first time in their history. Scenes of delight around Ayresome Park. There are fans all over the pitch, and who would deny them their moment of glory too? They've waited so long for this. At last, Middlesbrough, under the guidance of Bruce Rioch, have made it to the famous Twin Towers. And the fans just can't control their elation. They're swarming all over the field now. That's how it finished. Middlesbrough winning 2-1 on the night, 4-2 on aggregate. And Aston Villa, very much the favourites before the two matches were played, have missed out. Going so well in the First Division, but they weren't strong enough to overcome Middlesbrough. We'll be back after a short break. Stay with us.
Coming to Scotland.
I was inside the winner's dressing room with the Middlesbrough players. Matthew.
Welcome to the Boro dressing room. With me, the man who's taken Middlesbrough to the first Wembley Cup final in their 114-year history. Congratulations, Bruce.
Great, great night for us. Great night. We went a goal down, as you know, and it was difficult for us. I mean, Villa made it very hard for us tonight and came here and really played well in that first 45-minute period. Made it hard, but we've got a great group of young players here. A lot of Boro boys, born and bred here on Teesside. Love their club, die for their club, and I'm delighted for them because they've done great. They really have done tremendous.
Was there a time late in the second half when you thought it was all going to go wrong?
No, we knew that, knew at one goal down that we were still in there with a fighting chance, obviously. And we said at full time, going into extra time, you know, we're the Boro, let's go out there and win the game.
When you say the score of the second goal, or the first goal for you on the night, what did you feel when that one went in?
The second, Bernie Slaven's goal was world class, absolutely world class. You couldn't get a goal scorer anywhere in the world to score any better. Brilliant.
What a weekend it's been for him. He's been called up to the Northern Ireland squad. Do you think on merit?
Oh, I think so. I wasn't surprised that he was called up, and it's been a bonus day for him as well. Bonus day for all the club. Delight for our chairman and the club and everybody associated with Middlesbrough.
Let's have a go. Where is Bernie now? Bernie, just a quick word. Congratulations, quite a weekend for you. A call up for the Republic of Ireland squad and a goal tonight.
Yeah, outstanding tonight. The lads played terrific. Good working performance, and we're at Wembley. Can't believe it.
What does it mean to be going to Wembley for the first time?
Well, I've been here 4.5 years, and all the fans always say we'll never get to Wembley. The bus would break down on the way there. But we're there, and hopefully the bus makes it.
Congratulations, Bernie. With that, back to you, Paul.
Thanks very much indeed. Worth hanging down there for a glass of the free champagne, I should think. Peter Wood, quick word from you. Congrats to the winners.
Brilliant. I thought it was, as Ron said, over the two legs, I thought they were the best team, really.
Okay, Peter, it's been a pleasure to have you with us. It's been a great pleasure to have you with us for the start of something really exciting here on Sky. More live cup action coming next week. In the meantime, from all of us at Ayresome Park and the whole of that crowd out there who's going to stay to celebrate for an hour or two, I should think, thanks very much for being with us. 140 years of history end here.